How should you write your method section for your journal articles or your research papers? That's what we're going to be discussing in this video today. Before I get started, you can download my scientific research paper checklist. It has a lot of this information within it, and that will be a link in the description below. So let's get started with what should be in your research article method section. And really, I think about four different sections whenever I'm talking about writing a method section. The very first section is how did you manage your sample? So this is kind of very generic question, specific so that you can apply it to whatever field you're in. So if you're writing a research article, you got data, and if you got data, you had some sample that you're collecting data from. This could be using a public data set, that would then be your sample, and you need to talk about what sample they used to collect that data from. This could be, in my example in chemistry, from making solutions. Therefore, I need to talk about my solution prep. What did I do to create these samples that I'm going to analyze? If you're doing more human subjects or animal subjects, then you need to talk about how you included or excluded, how you found people, or how you raised your animals, and any protocols that you need, whether that's IAB or IACUC protocols, to show that you did all of this work ethically. If you're creating, you know, materials, you need to explain how you created those materials that you're then going to analyze. So overall, just think about what was the sample that you collected data from, and you need to explain the information about that sample. The second thing you need to include within your method section is how you collected your data. So again, this is going to be really different depending on what field you're in and what type of techniques you're using. If you're an analytical chemist like me, I used analytical instruments like mass spectrometry and ion mobility, liquid chromatography, to collect my data. So I need to explain everything about the instruments I used and how I used them to collect that data. If you are doing like surveys or interviews, you need to explain your surveys. You should probably include your survey as supplemental information or your interview questions as supplemental information. And you need to explain what were your protocols for completing those surveys. And then even then, were there exclusion or inclusion criteria that you applied to any outliers in the surveys or anything like that? Overall, you just need to think about how did I collect my data and what would someone else need to know to collect the same data that I did. The third thing you should talk about is how to analyze your data. So once you have this data collected, it's in its raw format. How did you convert it from that raw format into actually analyzed data for you to be able to make conclusions off of? So a lot of time this is going to include any form of specific instrument data analysis that you did, what parameters you used. This can include if you're doing qualitative data, how did you code your data? How did you identify themes in your data? Anything about how you use that qualitative data to reach your conclusions. If you are doing statistical analysis, this is going to include what softwares you use for your statistical analysis, what assumptions you made, what types of statistical analysis you did. So you want to include any piece of information that helps you to analyze your data to be able to generate conclusions. The fourth thing that you want to talk about is how did you present your data for publication? So you may have analyzed your data, but then you might have created certain figures to be able to present your data, or you might have done any number of other things to be able to present your data in a specific way. Even things like if you're working with qualitative data, how did you choose which quotes to pull out versus other quotes? This helps another researcher to be able to look at how you presented your data, and because it's really easy to manipulate your data to say what you want it to say just by excluding certain things or anything like that. So when you're not providing all of the raw data, it's really helpful for them to know how you chose to present that data. You want to include any software that you use to create figures or generate any examples for your data. And then you also want to include any type of manipulation or analysis that you did to make things even clearer for presentation of your data as well. So once you have these four things, the next step is figuring out how are you going to write it, right? So you can write down what are all the things that you did, and now it's how do you actually write out your section? And because this is different for every single type of field, there's really one main rule to go by to be able to write a really well-written method section. And that's basically write out a protocol that somebody else in your field could follow and get your same data. So if somebody had your exact same sample, tell them, how did you collect your sample? What was anything that you think would be important if you were telling someone else in your lab how to do this? A good way to do this is with some of your basic protocols. You may want to walk through and try and train someone in them and be like, okay, what makes sense? What doesn't make sense? All of these things. And what you're going to realize is, oh, this is really important. Like, you need to have this parameter set or else you're going to get this. And so if you're thinking about that's what you would tell someone else, then that needs to be written in your method section as well. So for the final component, let's go through a couple different examples that are in fairly different research fields. And these are both examples that I wrote in our published papers. So the first paper we're going to look at is liquid chromatography, ion mobility, spectrometry, mass spectrometry analysis of multiple classes of steroid hormone isomers in a mixture. So if I jump down, I'm going to jump down to the experimental. That's what their method section is called in this journal. So you can see there are three different headings here for the experimental. Solution preparation. So this is how was the sample created, collected, all of that. LC, IMS, and MS conditions. This is how did I collect my data? And then resolution and collision cross-section determination. That's essentially how I analyze my data. So if we look, we can see that for this example, I state where all of my actual chemicals came from to create my solutions. Then the next thing I did is tell them how I created my solution. So you can see here that the steroid mixture was made at this concentration and then in what solvents it was made. And then I even give all of the different information into a supplementary material section. So this is really nice. Instead of saying that, you know, I did this and this and this and this and this within your experimental, you can just really clearly lay it out within a supplementary material section or give a table of the information just to clean up your method section a little bit. And then you can see that for analysis, 2.5 microliters was injected into the LC, and I went ahead and told them how much of each component that would actually be. So this is part of actually the data collection section, right? How was I actually collecting the data? And then water and methanol. So then I stated what my mobile phase was here. Water, methanol with lithium acetate added were used as the mobile phase. So overall, that's just basically saying, how did I prepare everything that I needed to collect my data? So the LC IMS MS conditions, this is basically what I was doing to do my data collection. So I did LC IMS MS analysis. And so this is basically what were the instruments I was using, what was the types of gradient that I ran through. And again, I include these in supplementary tables to show the specific numbers instead of including them written out in my method section. This is more about the different parameters I used. And this is really helpful because we know that if we don't include these certain parameters, someone could get very different results from us. So it's important to show that. It's also really helpful if someone else does get different results from us, but then they know, oh, these parameters likely caused this difference, and that can be a discussion point. And then this is data analysis here. So up here's the data collection, down here's data analysis. So I'm including what softwares I used for analysis, and then further visualization. This is really how I presented my data for publication. So you can see these were just really the softwares that I used in this. And then up here, I do go into a little bit more detail about the specific analyses. So there's specific two calculations that I use within this actual paper. And so we can see that this sentence right here is not only how am I analyzing my data, but also how I'm presenting my data. So I'm saying exactly what I used within this software. And then within that, I got the LC or IMS drift time and the width. And then I've used this to find the resolution, and I include the equation in here. So being really clear about how I'm doing my analysis for my resolution. And then I also show how I'm doing it for calculating the collision cross section. So this is again my data analysis, and then a little bit of my data presentation here. And overall, that's all I need for someone else to be able to replicate this with the additional supplementary materials. That's all I really needed to do for my methods section. Now I'm gonna jump over to a very, very different type of paper. So this is toxicant exposure during pregnancy increases protective proteins in the dam and a sexually dimorphic response in the fetus. So this is a proteomics paper done on animals, specifically animals exposed to pesticides. So you can see this methods again has three different sections. It has animal handling and treatment. So that's obviously how was my sample collected or managed. Then discovery proteomics, that's how I collected my data. And then a statistical analysis, how I analyzed my data and a little bit of how I presented it for this paper as well. So if I come up here to animal handling and treatment, you can see always include your protocols. Whenever you're dealing with animals or humans, you need to include those protocols, what my sample was, and then all of this is basically how they were treated. And we again include any manufacturer of chemicals that we purchased for our analysis or treatment. Discovery proteomics, this is, again, a little bit of sample collection initially. And then, so all of this is sample collection. And then in here, we get into still a little bit of sample collection, but specifically for the analysis that we're doing or the cleaning of our samples for the analysis that we're doing. So all of this is basically saying how we got to from our animal to our actual sample that we're gonna run on the mass spectrometer. And then down here is what we did on the mass spectrometer. This is data collection here. And then these last two down here are the beginnings of the data analysis. So this is specifically how we went from just a bunch of mass spec peaks to essentially actually having protein concentrations. So then statistical analysis is all pretty much data analysis. This whole paragraph up here is talking about what is being compared when we make certain statements. And then we're talking about our statistical tests. So we use t-tests with FDR correction. And then this is different softwares that we're using as well. And down here, we're talking about how we did a Richmond analysis. This is all, again, a little bit of both data analysis and how we showed it for publication. This piece right here is all about how we're showing it for publication. So we're talking about how we showed Venn diagrams of the information to make it a lot clearer for people to be able to understand. And then this is a little bit more data analysis and graphical summaries of PCAs that is presenting for publication. So essentially you can see in two very different subfields of the same area, the exact same questions really apply. How did you collect your sample? How did you collect your data? How did you analyze your data? And then how did you present it for publication? Then sharing everything someone else would need to know in that if they are someone actually informed in your field to be able to perform this experiment themselves. If this video was really helpful, I really suggest you checking out my Write Your Research Article course. It is a course that walks you through all the different steps and even more detail than this, going from how to create your data story all the way to the publication process. I will also leave a few videos up here. This one's gonna be about how to write and publish your research article. It's a really high level overview of the entire process. And then this one over here is going to be about how to write your abstract for your research article as well. I hope this video was helpful and I look forward to seeing you in the next one.